why education has become a problem in the world is, people become who they are in the world because of what they have gathered. This is a very unfortunate situation. Right now, whether it is material things or knowledge, whatever information they have gathered, it makes them who they are. Now, who you are and what you have gathered are two different things. This is the distinction we are trying to bring into child's life in our schools. Whatever you may gather, it doesn't matter. What you gather is just information and things. Information is a thing by itself. It should not determine who you are. Who you are is determined by a different process, what you gather by a different process. So when I keep repeating to everybody, lot of these people feel ashamed, my guru is uneducated, they try to say, no, he only says that he's really educated. What I'm saying is, whatever I have gathered does not determine who I am. Because the biggest problem in the world is this, from the day you are born, all kinds of people are trying to teach you something that's not worked in their life.
I think if I can say, one of the major problems is that we didn't have systems of mass education as we know them now, pretty much until the middle of the 19th century. You know, they were invented, made up.
Part of industrialization.
Yes, it was part of the Industrial Revolution, and it was associated with the big move from the countryside into the cities to provide a workforce for the industrial economy. It's very straightforward from that point of view. It was a massive piece of social engineering. It's why the system is shaped the way it was. We needed a majority of people to do blue-collar work, which is why we had a broad base of elementary education, and a relatively small group of people to do clerical administrative work in suits, which is why we had a small university sector. And the system was created that way. In Britain, you know, when I was at school, at the age of 11, well, we all took an exam, I'm sure Ian would remember it, it's called 11 Plus, and it determined at the age of 11 which type of school you went to, at which sort of high school, a grammar school or a secondary modern school. It was really an IQ test, but people thought it was a blood test, you know, that told them how smart they were. And actually, it was just a capacity to do that type of test. And like a driving test, you could get better at it. And I mean, a lot of people were trained to do it, and they got through it. But the consequence of it is that we created this kind of system where there were a small group of winners, and they did very well by it, but the vast majority didn't. And part of the problem, as I see it, is that the system of education is burdened with certain ideological assumptions. One of them is a whole set of ideas about intelligence. So the whole ideal of Western education is to get people to university. And therefore, and it's because the universities abrogated the system to their own purposes. And therefore we have in the system this deeply mistaken assumption that that intelligence is the same thing as academic ability. An academic ability is very important, but it's a very specific capacity, you know, the capacity to do certain types of deductive reasoning, certain types of critical discourse. But the upshot is that if you're not very good at that, you're thought not to be very smart. Because the truth is, if you create a very narrow conception of ability, you create a very big conception of disability and inability. As we're doing personal stories for a second, I'm from Liverpool in England, and I'll mention one thing. I went to school across the city centre from the Liverpool Institute, which is where Paul McCartney was at school. I didn't know him then. I'm sure some of you people do know him quite well. But I wrote a book a few years ago called The Element, How Finding Your Passion Changes Everything. And I interviewed lots of people for the book, one of whom was Paul McCartney. And I tell you this because I think it's very important you don't leave here today unaware of the fact that I hang out with Paul McCartney. Anyway, Paul, as I call him, I asked him, I interviewed him for the book, and I said, did you enjoy music at school? And he said no, he hated it. I said, did your music teacher think you had any talent? He said, no, not really. He does, doesn't he? And then one of the other people in the same music program in the same school was George Harrison, the lead guitarist of the popular music group, the Beatles. And I said, did your music teacher think you, George, had any talent? He said, no, not really. I said, well, look, would this be a reasonable comment that there was this one music teacher in Liverpool in the late 1950s who had half the Beatles in his class and he missed it? He said, yes. Well, it's a bit of an oversight, isn't it? So, anybody stand out in your class this year, Mr. Wilcox? Not really. Nobody leaps forward, frankly. What I mean is, if you create this narrow view of ability, then you automatically suit all this other stuff. I mean, Sankara may remember this, but in the 50s, there was a big polio epidemic, you know, that ran right through America and Europe, and I got it. You know, I was one of I'm one of seven kids. I was the only one in the family to get it, and the only one in the street to get it, you know, despite my vigorous attempts to cross-infect the entire neighborhood. You know, I thought, you're coming down with me, you know. But anyway, I was in hospital, and I ended up going to into special ed from 5 till 11, and that's what they used to do. So I was in a school which had lots of kids with polio, lots of kids with cerebral palsy, partially sighted, blind, deaf kids. I was sitting next to one kid in school who had a really bad case of cerebral palsy. And it's a terrible thing to deal with, you know, because if you don't have it, you know, if you can just, to move your arms around, you just have to relax muscles and contract them. You don't think about it. But if you've got cerebral palsy, are affected by it, you're fighting your body all the time, so you're doing this type of stuff. And if you try to speak and it's affected your face, it's you sound as if you're talking nonsense. And of course, you may be talking absolute sense, it's just you can't get the sounds out. Anyway, so the guy sitting next to me my final year at the school couldn't grip a pencil in his fingers, but he could grip it in his toes. And he had beautiful writing, better than mine, actually. Was this handwriting? We don't know. but the point is, we were surrounded by people like this. I mean, my classroom at school was like the barroom scene from Star Wars. You know, there were kind of people in various degrees of decrepitude, you know, being brought in. But nobody was interested in what people's disabilities seemed to be. What we're interested in is what they were good at, and if they were smart or interesting or what. And the fact is that many of the things that they had difficulty with weren't what really defined them. But because there's this narrow view of ability, if you have trouble writing or speaking, it's assumed that you have some associated mental incapacity, which is why you get this big conception of disability surrounding it. But if you reframe the conception of ability, suddenly you discover all these talents and possibilities that are inherent all the time. Now, I mention it because it's a dramatic example, at least special ed is to me, of what happens all the time in general education. All kinds of kids are told they've got problems who don't have them. They're created by the system. And it's the problem of the system that we need to address, that if you reframe ability, all of these difficulties that people seem to be suffering from suddenly disappear. If you find the things they're good at, if you do as Sadhguru is suggesting, if you create an environment which is holistic, which is addressing your spiritual development, your physical development, which recognizes that human life is not linear, it's organic, and it will take many different courses, then you have a completely different setting of conditions under which people will flourish. And it's the fact that the conditions themselves, which are industrial in character, create problems for kids, which they then begin to rail against. So we now have a system based on competition, narrow view of ability, and one in which people are being medicated to stay with the program. They're being pathologized for losing interest in what is essentially very boring stuff. We sit them down all day long and wonder why they fidget. And there are different ways of doing it, better ways. I mean, for me, it's as plain as day, really. You know, education is not one of those things like an incurable disease and we can't figure out what to do. We know what to do in education. It's about taking this thing to scale. But taking it to scale doesn't mean replicating it, because, as you say, there's no perfect school. Actually, there are no two schools alike, but like there are no two individuals alike. But there are principles you can apply everywhere. And getting those principles in place, to me, is the big challenge now.